Yeah, crews have been combing through the debris of the bridge since before dawn this morning. The bridge came crumbling down onto the Dali, which sails out of Singapore, a 985-foot-long cargo ship that struck one of the bridge's support columns around 1:30 this morning. We're told a total of 8 people were filling potholes on the bridge at that time, and 6 of them remain missing. One was sent to shock trauma in serious condition and has since been released, and one other refused treatment. All crew members on board the Dali have been accounted for, and none of them were hurt. Governor Wes Moore told us earlier today that the Dali's crew issued a Mayday call moments before impact. He says this allowed officials to shut down the bridge and prevent further tragedy, and the response to the key bridge's collapse has been historic, with dozens of agencies from the local to the federal levels working together to find those workers and determine exactly what went wrong.
11 News anchor Kai Reed joins us from the live desk. And Kai, this will be really an all hands on deck ordeal for the foreseeable future.
Oh, definitely for quite some time. The NTSB gave an update earlier this afternoon as they started this massive investigation. Here's what they had to say about the teamwork involved in an incident of this scale.
This is a team effort. There are a lot of entities right now in the command post, all focused on search and rescue as they should be. But I do want to in particular thank the Coast Guard, the Maryland Transportation Authority Police, the Federal Bureau of Investigations, the Baltimore Fire and Rescue, and the Maryland State Police. I also know that there are others on scene I'm sure I have missed. For example, Army Corps of Engineers is here. A great deal of expertise, and all focused on what is very important, which is the people first.
Now, Jennifer Hamady, chair of the NTSB, also says while it's been several hours since the initial collapse, there's still a lot they can't share as local, state, and federal agencies come together to figure out what went wrong here. Here's what she said about that.
Not a lot of information that I can share at this time, and I know there's a lot of information that seems to be circulating. The NTSB doesn't speculate. We provide facts. And so there isn't a lot we can share right now because the focus has been on the people. However, if you know me, I like to provide information as we can when we're able to verify those facts and be open about that. Transparency is one of our mandates, one of our core values. So please monitor NTSB.gov and X.
Oh, the NTSB was also asked about next steps, even though the search and rescue effort is still well underway right now. Here was the response to that.
What's the priority beyond the search and rescue? Certainly investigations are a priority. Certainly environmental considerations are a priority. And so is traffic and getting, you know, cargo vessels in and out of the port of Baltimore. It's not the NTSB's priority. We have a number of organizations, including the Department of Transportation, Maryland Department of Transportation, the governor, that's doing a lot of work on that. But this is it. Right now, it's about people. It's about families and addressing the needs of those that were impacted. That's the focus. I don't think anybody in that room right now at the command post is thinking about what are the next steps to get things cleaned up. They're working to figure out who was impacted, if anyone was impacted, and how do we address that, because that is and should be the priority always.
Okay, a lot of information there from the NTSB. City and state leaders have been at that scene all day long, giving updates and sharing as much as they can with the public. We will have more on that coming up in just a few minutes, Ashley and Andre.
Well, President Biden has vowed the federal government will cover the repair for the bridge, whatever the cost may be.
In addition to the more than 30,000 commuters who used to cross that bridge every day, its collapse into the Patapsco River has left the port paralyzed.
As I told Governor Moore, I've directed my team to move heaven and earth to reopen the port and rebuild the bridge as soon as humanly possible. And we're going to work hand in hand with the support of Maryland to support Maryland, whatever they ask for. We're going to work with our partners in Congress to make sure the state gets the support it needs.
And that rebuilding process starts with the investigation into the bridge's final moments.
And we have team coverage. Tori Yorgi and Kyrie Stewart are standing by with how residents on both sides of the port are processing the tragedy.
Yeah, but we begin with 11 News anchor Deborah Wiener in Dundalk. And Deb, you spoke with Governor Wes Moore just a short time ago.
Andre, barring any major developments, we are not expecting additional comments this evening publicly before cameras from Governor Wes Moore. So before he left this point here in Dundalk, he stopped and spoke to us, and here's what he had to say. Governor, today you have been Comforter-in-Chief. You met with the families, and I know that was very difficult for you and for them. What can you share with us?
These families are remarkable. You know, when their family members left them for the evening, they never think that that was going to be the final result. So we just prayed with them, and we prayed for them, and we let them know that we're going to have them not just in our prayers, but we're going to have them and have their backs always.
What can you tell us right now about the search for these six individuals?
The search and it's an active search and rescue mission. It is still ongoing, and. You know, I think about these first responders. You know, they've been, you know, and I have instructed every asset in our state's power, air, land, and sea, to conduct these operations. We've received supports from other states, from our federal partners, from our local partners. And I think about just the heroism of these first responders who have been working around the clock to be able to find survivors. And so it's still an active search and rescue process, but I'm just so grateful to our first responders for their work.
When you look out at that scene, when all of us look out at that scene, it remains unbelievable no matter how many times we look at it.
I mean, it takes your breath away. I don't. This has been here since 1977. It's been here for as long as I've been here, as long as I've ever known this skyline. So to look at here, to look and see the Key Bridge gone, it just doesn't look familiar. And I remember the call that I got in the middle of the night where my chief of staff, he said to me, he said, the Key Bridge is gone. And I said, what do you mean gone?
Right.
And he said, it collapsed. You don't expect to hear those words. And I think it's still very much sinking in for me, and I know for everyone else in our state.
Your last conversation with the president, he vowed to continue to support these efforts here. What else did he share with you?
The president and their team have been spectacular. Literally from the middle of the night last night, I think Secretary Buttigieg called me at 3:30 in the morning to check on to see what we needed. They have been so responsive and so supportive. And I think the thing that the president said publicly was what he said to me privately, was that we are going to rebuild this, and we are going to rebuild it together.
Governor, what can the average Marylander do as we continue to cover this catastrophe and we pray for the family members?
Well, I think prayer works and prayer matters. Please pray for these families. They are having a really difficult day, and I think we need to remember them in our prayers. I also think that Marylanders have to remember to take care of each other. This is going to be a long journey. This is not going to be a day, it's not going to be a week, it's not going to be a month. This is going to be a long journey when it comes to truly focusing on rebuilding. But the thing I know is this, is that we are Maryland tough, and we are Baltimore strong. And as long as we do that and focus on that, we are going to be just fine.
Governor Wes Moore, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Governor Wes Moore, on what is no doubt one of the most difficult days as governor and one of the most difficult days for Maryland. Send it back to you guys.
Our colleague and friend Deborah Wiener having a very sobering conversation with Governor Wes Moore about the federal, state, and local cooperation into the catastrophe of the Key Bridge collapse.
And speaking of that collaboration, state, federal, and local, we want to go back out to our Deborah Wiener in Dundalk, and she's talking with Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski. Deb, go ahead, take it from here.
Yeah, thank you. Johnny Olszewski, who has been on the ground here since you got this call at 2 in the morning. What can you update us about? You had a very sobering conversation with some of the officers who were first on the scene. What can you tell me about that?
Yeah, so after getting the call early from our fire chief, we spent most of the day both thanking our first responders who are doing incredible work, but I also learned of the heroism. So we had a chance talking to some of the Maryland Transportation Authority officers, and we learned today through our briefings that between the May Day that went out and the bridge collapse, it was a very short window, less than 2 minutes. So precious seconds, but these officers sprung right to action, and without flinching, without thinking. They moved to action. They were able to close both sides of the bridge. And, you know, I can't calculate how many lives they saved, but as tragic and as horrific as today has been, we know that the bravery of these officers surely saved additional lives and, you know, prevented this from being an even larger catastrophe. So, you know, we're already hearing sort of these glimmers of heroism and, you know, signs of hope in terms of what's happened. We did a joint service with Mayor Scott and others at Turner Station not far from here. Yeah. But just the spirit and the mood of, like, you know, even in this time of great sadness and sorrow and shock, there are these glimmers, and it's been pretty incredible to be a part of today, even as we pray for and are sad about those who we're still looking for.
I was saying that no matter how many times we look out at this bridge, no matter how many times we look at that surreal video, it still, hours later, seems absolutely hard to fathom.
Yeah, it's hard to believe that it's real. It's very painful and very personal for those of us who have experienced that bridge as a way of life. We cross it regularly. We fish under it. We go to, you know, school and jobs as a result of it. We know the port is fueled by it. And so, you know, we're very much focused on the rescue and the search mission right now still. But, you know, thinking down the road, it is just hard to fathom a skyline without the Key Bridge. It's hard to fathom, you know, not having that access. So it still very much is seems unreal. I think a lot of folks are still in shock. And even as we're actively trying to address the rescue and the search, as we're trying to address the transportation needs and the challenges, as we try to talk to the president and get the resources to reopen the port and to rebuild the bridge, it's still hard to believe that it actually happened today.
Johnny Oshevsky, thank you so much for talking to us. We appreciate you being here.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you for making time for us. So here we are as the sun is setting on what is a day that where history was made as history fell into the water behind us. A gentleman living over there said he lost a friend today, looking back at this bridge, which has meant so much to his family and his life. So we continue to pray for the families that are affected, and we wish them peace. I'm going to send it back to you guys.
All right, Deborah, thank you. And coming up, few people were awake to see the bridge come down, but those that did were just horrified.
And still ahead, we speak to a woman who saw the horror unfold right before her eyes. We continue our breaking news coverage of the collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge. And whether we drove over that bridge every day or admired it as a staple of the Baltimore skyline, this tragedy is taking a toll across Baltimore.
Yeah, and that's why city and county leaders teamed up with the coalition of faith leaders to help everyone process this loss. 11 News' Kyrie Stewart joins us from Mount Olive Baptist Church, where a prayer service just wrapped up. Kyrie?
Yeah, that's right. You know, that prayer vigil that is started a little after 5 o'clock and ended just before 6 o'clock. Community, hope, strength, those were all the themes of it. Mayor Scott was here, County Executive Johnny O was here, and I'm telling you, it was a really good turnout of people. I want you all to take a look at some video we shot of it. Now, the whole thing started with just a song. You know, everybody came together, they sang, and then the pastor got up and he started to get people to pray and just talk about why it's important for everybody to come together and just provide support for the community. You know, he talked about just the strength that Baltimoreans have in this area and talked about how we're going to get through this kind of thing. Mayor Scott also got up there as well. You know, he called this just an unthinkable tragedy, something we're all thinking right now. He said that we all need to come together and just lift up the families, the first responders. He thanked the clergy as well. County Executive John Yeo, he did the same thing, saying that we all need to pray for the families and just really uplift them. But one thing that really got me, and I mentioned this earlier, is when both Mayor Scott and County Executive John Yeo, they got to the front of the altar and just all of the clergy members, you know, all of the community leaders, they surrounded them and they really prayed for them. You know, that was probably the most touching moment of that entire prayer vigil. That's the part that really sticks out to me. You know, on top of that, Bill Ferguson, State Senator Bill Ferguson, he was here as well. And then you had different members from just other religions that came as well, just to talk about why it's important that community comes together, you know, to really help and really just keep the community going and just instill strength in everybody. So I want you all to take a listen to what the pastor had to say. We spoke to him before the service. Take a listen to what he had to say just about why it's important that we all come together to help the community here.
I'm saddened by the lives that were affected by this. I know that we can get through it, but it's going to be a while. This was a very traumatizing situation. And so we're going to have to support this community for the days and weeks to come.
And I'm joined here with two people who were actually at that service. What's your name?
Stephen.
Stephen, and what's your name?
Oprah Clemens.
Just tell me, well, first of all, I'm gonna start with you, Stephen. You live right around the corner from here, and you told me that you can actually see the bridge from your house.
Yes, I did. When I got up this morning and looked to my right, the bridge was no longer there. It was like an invisible spot. So I went to check the news to see what was going on, and yeah, tragedy, real bad.
What's been going through your head all day? I can't imagine.
Man, I've been praying for the families and the victims on that bridge, and just thinking about, you know, I could have been on that bridge, and my family could have been on that bridge. So, and then what can I do to help? So that's one of the things I was thinking about.
I appreciate that. And you know, you really mentioned it yourself. You know, you could have been on that bridge. I know the president said that around 30,000 people take that bridge every day. You know, so it's just really unthinkable, just really what happened here. But again, the whole theme of really what happened here, the prayer vigil, was just hope, community, and strength. So we're going to continue to talk to people all around here. I'm going to send it back to you guys in the studio.
All right, Kyrie, thank you. The crash, though, it could be heard across South Baltimore and in the coastal communities from Curtis Bay all the way down into Anne Arundel County. So many places people witnessed this and heard it.
What happened at 1:30 this morning. 11 News anchor Deborah Wiener joins us again live from Dundalk. And Deb, even the people who saw the Key Bridge collapse say they can't even believe what played out right before their eyes.
Right before their eyes, as they were laying in bed, they said it felt like an earthquake, that their home shook. When we got here on the scene, I spoke to a woman who hadn't told her story yet. She said she was not comfortable yet speaking about it because it was so traumatic. And then I got to speak to Darlene, and she shared with me for the first time what that experience was like. Take a listen.
My first thought was, how many people were on the bridge when it collapsed? That was the first thought. Second thought was, I was glad that Joe wasn't on the bridge at that time in the morning. It was tragic. It was just a tragic feeling. You know, your heart just sinks, you know, and you can look at it and you just still can't believe it.
all of our hearts have sank today. She was talking about Joe, her partner, who takes that bridge every morning, and he usually takes it around 4:30 in the morning, and obviously did not traverse that route today. We want to thank Darlene, and we want to thank Will for Joe, rather. I've been calling him Will. I'm sorry. Darlene and Joe for sharing their story and for sharing their part of the world here in Dundalk as we cover this terrible catastrophe. We thank them for their kindness and for letting us use their restroom and just being part of their lives for this short period of time. We could not have done this here without them. So I'm going to send it back to you guys.
Now, your WBAL-TV 11 weather forecast with Chief Meteorologist Tom Tasselmeyer.
Well, the weather's been fairly quiet today, but that's about to change a bit. You can see rain approaching us on radar now, just to the west of Hagerstown, moving down into northern Virginia. Possibility of a few sprinkles tonight, but a better chance for showers as we head into tomorrow afternoon. Futurecast at 3 on Wednesday shows widespread showers and cool temperatures, and that will probably linger into Wednesday evening and maybe even the early morning or first half of the day on Thursday. But good news for the Orioles. Looks like as the day wears on Thursday, that rain will move closer to the coast and then finally offshore. So our rain chances for the Oriole game on Thursday are actually going down a bit. Chance for showers and chilly tonight down to 43, and then highs tomorrow should be in the low 50s with off and on rain showers and cloudy skies throughout the day. Mostly central and eastern Maryland tomorrow, maybe a little sun in the mountains. Thursday, again, most of the showers go over to the eastern shore by afternoon, so the Oriole forecast looks a little better. Just a 30% chance of a couple showers and temperatures. Not too bad for opening day at Oriole Park. We'll be back with more news right after this.
This?
Who's
what
the presser
presser
with?
Is this? We
don't. State Police and Coast Guard.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Lieutenant Luke.
Right now, we're going to go to a joint news conference going on right now.
Yes, State Police and the U.S. Coast Guard. Let's listen in.
And after that, we'll be able to take a few questions, but we do need to keep it brief because we want to get these folks back to work. With that, I'd like to introduce Rear Admiral Shannon Gilreath.
Hey, good evening, everyone. First, I'd like to say thank you to all of the first responders that have come out today to assist in looking for these individuals. We've had tremendous support across the state, and county and city and federal enterprise. You've seen for yourself the helicopters flying over, the small boats that are out there, the Coast Guard cutter that's out there, the boats that go back and forth bringing people out on scene to search for these individuals. So thank you to this entire community for helping in that regard. Second, I want to say thank you to the community for the outpouring of support to those first responders, and in particular the outpouring of support and prayers and support for the families of the six individuals. So I would like to announce tonight that based on the length of time that we've gone in this search, the extensive search efforts that we've put into it, the water temperature, that at this point we do not believe that we're going to find any of these individuals still alive. And so this evening at around 7:30, we are going to suspend the active search and rescue efforts. Coast Guard's not going away, none of our partners are going away, but we're just going to transition to a different phase. And so I'm going to turn it over to Colonel Butler, please.
Good evening, and thank you all for being here. To echo the Admiral's comments here, we really appreciate the support from the community to all the first responders here. We appreciate your patience and allowing us to do the best job possible and get the information as it comes up. At this point, as the Admiral said, we're going away from the search and rescue portion to a recovery operation. The changing conditions out there have made it dangerous for the first responders, the divers in the water. We will still have surface ships out overnight. At 0600 hours tomorrow, we are hoping to put divers in the water and begin a more detailed search to do our very best to recover those six missing people.
Thank you. With that, we have time for just a few questions. We know there's a lot of questions that still have to be answered, and we do have time for just a few. So if we could take a few, please.
So do we think it's still just six? There's talk of maybe other cars on the bridge.
All the information we have is it's six individuals.
Got it.
Yes, sir.
Can you go into detail about how difficult this might be for the recovery phase of this now? Like, what kind of challenges are you up against?
Well, I'll start by saying I'm going to turn it over to the experts on diving. I'm not an expert on diving, but we've got very difficult water temperatures. You have structures from the bridge that are in the water that can move with the tides and currents, making that dangerous for divers and people in the water to actually try to do recovery. And we do not want to injure any of these first responders in this recovery effort. We absolutely want to be as safe as possible for everyone involved in this. And I'll see if Colonel Bell has anything he wants to add.
Can you go into specifics about what the search and rescue entailed, like were there scuba divers or was everything above water, sonar, any sort of equipment that might have been utilized over the past 12 hours?
From the outset, we moved all those resources in with dive teams from various state, local, and county agencies. We also used sonar. We're doing our very best in some very difficult times and difficult conditions, which is why we're making that transition now. The last thing we want to do is put divers in the water with changing currents, low temperatures, very poor visibility, and so much metal and other unknown objects in the water. All it takes is one object to strike an individual, and all of a sudden we have a first responder trying to recover another first responder. I think at 0600, we'll find ourselves in a better position to understand the dynamics of what we're dealing with and to address the issue in a much safer manner.
Did the authorities have six IDs now, and have those victims each been contacted, those families, I should say?
I can't speak on that. That's still in the investigative portion of this.
Can you speak to some of the difficulties in actually retrieving the remains? Have any remains been retrieved so far? We've also heard reports that there might be individuals trapped inside of vehicles, that there might be debris that has made it more challenging for FBI and other law enforcement to deploy.
All of that is unknown at this point, and as I said, we have to cease operations. We can't start again until we can assure the safety of those divers and the rescue personnel that are going to participate in this. If we look at how challenging it is at a simple motor vehicle crash to extract an individual, I'm sure we can all imagine how much harder it is to do it in inclement weather, when it's cold, under the water, with very limited to no visibility.
So just to clarify, no remains have been removed thus far by
That is correct.
So, Colonel, you're confident then that no other vehicles made it onto that bridge before the collapse, or as it was collapsing, I should say?
Based upon the fact the original information that was provided, the Maryland Transportation Authority Police Department was able to shut down traffic. Is there the possibility that there was another vehicle on there other than those vehicles involved in the construction process? I think we all would have to understand, yes, that's a distinct possibility. As unfortunate as may be, it's a distinct possibility. However, we don't have any information to support that at this point.
When
ma'am.
You bring the divers out, do you have an idea of where the individuals are, if they were in cars or not, and do you know how long the recovery effort is going to take?
We do not know at this point. I'm sure as you've seen some of the aerial photos, there is a tremendous amount of debris in the water, from containers hanging off ships. We have to make sure those are shored up. We're going to work with structural engineers to help them understand how to navigate and address the challenges of having bridge structure in the water that may be sharp, that could puncture a suit, that could puncture an airline. All of these are things that we must take our time with.
Do you know where the victims are located?
This last question, by the way.
I'm sorry?
Where the victims are located in the water? Have you been able to find them yet, or if they're in cars or not?
At this point, we do not know where they are, but we intend to give it our best effort to help these families find closure.
How might inclement weather tomorrow impact the recovery efforts?
Very clearly it could, but we're going to do everything in our power to help these families find closure.
How stable has the boat been? How stable has the boat been?
How do we get their names, title, spelling?
Folks, we're going to be establishing Unified Command as well as a Joint Information Center, and I know there's a lot of questions, and we're going to be providing that information where we will continue to provide updates. But that is the extent of our updates tonight. We thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Wow, we have just been listening to a joint news conference with the U.S. Coast Guard and the Maryland State Police talking about the events that happened 18 hours ago. That cargo vessel that we're looking at, Dolly, based out of Singapore, crashed into a column of the Francis Scott Key Bridge, causing the bridge to collapse into the Patapsco River. Eight workers, we're told, were on the bridge, filling in potholes at the time. Two were quickly recovered. The search effort was for six missing construction workers, and we just heard from authorities that due to the conditions in the water, mm-hmm. they do not believe it is likely that those six construction workers survive. So yeah. they are going to transition from a search and rescue effort to a recovery mission.
Yeah, those six workers presumed dead, and they mm-hmm. will be ending that effort about 7:30 tonight, mm-hmm. and like you mentioned, turning over to a recovery mission, and we'll begin that tomorrow morning. Eleven News spoke with NBC News transportation correspondent Tom Costello earlier today about the historic nature of this tragedy as well.
Yeah, 11 News anchor Kai Reed joins us from the live desk. And Kai, Tom told us that he has never seen anything of this magnitude.
That's right, and that's really saying something in all his years in journalism. A bridge collapse of this magnitude is something that nobody has ever seen before. Tonight, there are still a lot of unknowns, and Tom told us that getting to the bottom of this will require an extremely high number of resources.
Well, this is clearly going to be one of the biggest investigations the NTSB has handled in years. Now, a lot of people think of the NTSB as, of course, being the primary body for aviation accidents, but they do more than that. They do, of course, maritime accidents. This will be one of their biggest ever. They've got 24 investigators on the scene.
Well, Tom added there, we aren't going to get all of those answers quickly. As you might have heard at the NTSB press conference today, the agency does not speculate. It takes its time in collecting facts before laying everything out. That means we're looking at a long timeline here before we can say with exact certainty what happened in the early hours of the morning.
But the formal investigation, all the way through the board meeting, which will clearly probably end in a board meeting in Washington, D.C., that probably won't happen for a year, 18 months before they come up with a final determination of the cause.
Oh, in the meantime, NBC News has confirmed that the ship was investigated for propulsion deficiency years ago and previously had hit the port of Antwerp, and its hull was damaged. So Ashley and Andre, that is certainly information that there will be a lot of follow-up to get to the bottom of more information about this ship.
Yeah, absolutely, Kai. Mm-hmm. And of course, this all news, this news comes as a shock to Baltimore, really. But for the sailing community, even outside of Baltimore and outside of Maryland, the Francis Scott Key Bridge, it was a major destination. The organization Sailors for Sustainability passed by the bridge just yesterday as part of their circumnavigation. They took these photos just 7 hours before the collapse happened. Hard to believe. Just a beautiful shot there. You know, the calm atmosphere, it's really what the bridge looked like just yesterday afternoon. Such a juxtaposition of what we're seeing today.
Earlier today, the U.S. Transportation Secretary, Pete Buttigieg, called it one of the cathedrals of American infrastructure.
Huge deal. Mm-hmm. In the last 18 hours, that scene has obviously changed pretty drastically.
Yeah, 11 News investigative reporter Tali Taylor joins us now to walk us through this catastrophe second by second.
Hey guys, all right, so we're going to take you through the things that we notice as the ship, the dolly, makes its way towards the bridge and eventually collides. You can see here the dolly already in pitch black. We're at 1:25 a.m. This is just about 3 minutes until it collides with the Key Bridge. You can see here everything totally black. As far as we can tell, traffic is moving normally at this stage. You can see the construction lights right here. This is where we believe the construction crew was. And again, traffic making its way across. Now, you go back here. We're at almost 1:26 a.m. Some of the lights in the ship have started to come back on in the dolly. It's you can't tell yet, but it's going to make a turn towards the superstructure right here. As of now, it's pointed in a different direction. And again, we have another truck making its way across, followed by a semi-truck after that. Looks like traffic moving normally. You have to wonder, as they looked out to the right, if it looked like the ship was on a collision course. We'll see if we can find those drivers, see what they were thinking. But you start to see the black smoke billowing out here. We're trying to figure out more information about what that black smoke indicates, if that was normal or if that was an issue. Now, again, Governor Moore has told us that a Mayday alert went out from the ship. You can see it goes black here again. And that Mayday alert allowed officials and crews to stop vehicles from crossing the bridge. But that hasn't happened yet. We're at 1:26. We're about a minute and a half out until the collision happens. We have the last semi-truck making its way across. Again, lights here from the construction vehicles. Really, that's the only activity happening, right? We just have this one vehicle going across. We have the construction crews, and the ship is starting to make its final turn. This is where it's going to stay the course for the last minute before it collides. You can't really tell that it's moving, but it's making a steady course to collide with this very important structure right here supporting the bridge. Again, right now it's just sort of eerie, deathly silent, just the construction lights flashing here. These are the last two vehicles that make their way across from what we can tell. This is 1:27 a.m. This is about a minute exactly before the bridge collapses. So these last two vehicles make their way across. Again, you have to wonder, as they're making their way across, if they looked out to the right, have to wonder if they saw the ship coming, if they knew that it was going to collide, and if they drove a little bit faster as a result. So they make their way across here in the next couple seconds. You can see it's 1:28 a.m., and we're now just 30 seconds out from when the ship collides with the bridge. This is the Francis Scott Key Bridge, and you're going to see smoke billow out here. It's going to be a little grainy, but you'll see it happen, and then within 10 seconds, the entire structure will collapse. Now, again, no cars whatsoever at this point. We're told this is because of efforts to clear the bridge because of a Mayday call. And you'll see here in just a few seconds the smoke starting to come out, and then the bridge will collapse. It's going to happen right about now. You'll see the smoke start to come out here. There it is, coming out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Bam, the entire structure comes down. Collapses there, and we're at 1:28 a.m., almost 1:29 a.m. That's what we notice. Back to you.
This dramatic video, Telly Taylor walking us through what happened about 18 hours and 10 minutes ago.
And, you know, Carnival Cruise Lines is temporarily moving its Legends Baltimore operations to Norfolk, Virginia. The Carnival Legend was scheduled to return to Baltimore this Sunday, but, of course, now it will return to Norfolk, and then a bus service will bring passengers back to Baltimore. All upcoming cruises through Carnival will also go to and from Norfolk instead of Baltimore. So if you're planning a trip, you may want to check it, especially if you're on Carnival. That may be changed.
You talk about the cost of the human life lost, the traffic impact, the commerce impact. There's so many angles
to this.
It's
everywhere.
Huge story.
It is. All right, well, we have heard from President Joe Biden today, but other government officials are weighing in on the bridge collapse as well.
Yes, still ahead, we hear from Vice President Kamala Harris and Secretary of Transportation Pete Buttigieg about the federal response to this tragedy. Right, tonight, the outpouring of support for Baltimore is coming from authorities at the local, state, and federal levels.
Yeah, all over. And as we previously mentioned, President Biden has vowed to cover the repairs of the bridge. Vice President Kamala Harris and Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg both doubled down on that sentiment.
Before I begin, I will say a few words on the terrible accident in Baltimore this morning. I know we are all praying for the families of those who are missing and all those who have been touched by this tragedy. I spoke with the governor of Maryland this morning, and we have directed the federal government to use all the resources that are available to assist with the search and rescue, to reopen the port, and to rebuild the bridge as quickly as possible. And of course, I know we all will stand and continue to stand with the people of Maryland.
Excruciating day for several families who went to bed last night having it be a normal night and woke up today to news that no one wants to receive. They are hoping and praying, and we are hoping and praying with them. This is no ordinary bridge. This is one of the cathedrals of American infrastructure. It has been part of the skyline of this region for longer than many of us have been alive. So the path to normalcy will not be easy. It will not be quick, It will not be inexpensive, but we will rebuild together.
Well, rebuilding together was the message at a prayer vigil hosted by city and county leaders alongside a coalition of faith leaders.
11 News reporter Kyrie Stewart joins us from Mount Olive Baptist Church, where that prayer service wrapped up a short time ago. Kyrie.
Guys, I'm telling you, it was a big turnout, very emotional. You know, like you said, you had city leaders, you had county leaders, you had leaders from all different kinds of faiths that came here to Mount Olive Baptist Church for that prayer vigil. I want you all to take a look. You know, this happened, it started a little after 5 and it ended right before 6. But like I said, very emotional time here. The pastor got on stage, you know, he wanted everybody just to pray for the families, pray for the first responders, and pray for the community as well. Mayor Scott got up there, he talked about why it's important for us to uplift the families and uplift the first responders. Johnny O also went on stage as well, and he led a prayer for everybody. And on top of that, you know, a really touching moment was when they were both up there and people came together and they just prayed for this community. You know, that's what it's all about, you know, praying for the community. The pastor talked about just having strength as well to get us through this tragedy. I want you all to take a listen to what he had to say to me before the service.
The response has been tremendous. This community turn station is a historical African-American community. And so the resilience that resides in this community is amazing. And so I'm hoping that not just for these couple of days, but for months to come, that not only do we revitalize a bridge, but we also have the opportunity to revitalize a community.
And you know, to ride off of what he just said there, you know, he told me at the end that he plans on having the doors to the church open here. You know, if any first responders, if any of them want to come in and just rest or just to pray or anything, you know, he said that they can do that here. He said that he may spend the night here. On top of that, they're planning on handing out food as well. So again, it really just takes the community. That was the whole message, just people coming together to really help the families, help these first responders, and really just get through this tragedy, guys.
Thank you. And for decades, Baltimoreans have looked out over the city skyline and seen the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Tonight, though, that is not something you can do anymore.
After the break, we look back at the bridge's 47-year history and what it meant to Charm City. We'll be right back.
Well, the Francis Scott Key Bridge had been a staple of the Baltimore skyline for decades.
Yeah, it was just 3 days ago that a celebration was held honoring 47 years since the first people crossed that 1.6-mile bridge. 11 News reporter Barry Sims is looking at the legacy it leaves behind.
The bridge, named after Francis Scott Key, was an important part of Baltimore's infrastructure as well as city and U.S. history. These are pictures of the bridge's beginnings from the Maryland Department of Transportation. According to Maryland historians, construction began in August 1972. It officially opened to traffic March 23, 1977.
I think as a historian, the impact of what's happened here is profound. We'll be talking about it for years. This is a critical part of Baltimore's infrastructure, and you know, it's a total tragedy.
According to Preservation Maryland, the bridge was considered a major milestone in developing Maryland's highway system as it completed the Interstate 695 circuit around Baltimore. The cost to build, $100 million. The span of the steel truss bridge had four lanes and stretched 1.6 miles over the Patapsco River. It just had its 47th anniversary. Originally, two tunnels were considered before the bridge was built.
Originally, they had considered building two tunnels, and they built this bridge because they would be cheaper to build than a tunnel, but also they were concerned about being able to get hazardous materials across the harbor, and you know, that's going to be a problem now, as we know, being able to move materials without this bridge there.
Again, it was named after Francis Scott Key, who watched the bombardment of Fort McHenry during the War of 1812. It inspired Key to write the poem that inspired the Star Spangled Banner, the national anthem.
It's named the Francis Scott Key Bridge because it's believed that Key was about 100 yards away from it when he penned what would today become the Star Spangled Banner back in September of 1814. And then on the other side of it is Fort Carroll, which you can see, which is a historic fort down below it. So it's a very historic part of the harbor, and it was from there that obviously not only today can you see Fort McHenry, but it was visible to Francis Scott Key, which is why it's named in his honor.
Preservation Maryland's Nicholas Redding says that what's happened is going to have a profound impact, and he says that it's going to be an expensive endeavor to replace this important piece of infrastructure. Reporting from the newsroom, Barry Sims, WBAL-TV 11 News.
Generally light winds throughout the day today, nearly calm at Sparrows Point last check with only a gust to 7 miles an hour. So light winds, cloudy skies, and cool temperatures, 50 degrees at Sparrows Point right now, 50 at the Naval Academy, 56 at the Inner Harbor at the Maryland Science Center, only 49 degrees up at Hereford, and some rain is approaching from the west. This is going to be the area of wet weather coming through over the next couple of days that might impact our Oriole home opener on Thursday afternoon. There's a slight chance of a couple showers tonight, only scattered activity and chilly temperatures into the low 40s. Then tomorrow, scattered showers become more widespread and numerous, especially from mid-morning into the early afternoon. But with the clouds and showers around, temperatures are going to fall short of normal. Our normal high is 59, probably only in the low 50s tomorrow. Sunrise behind cloudy skies at 6:58. Western Maryland gets some sun tomorrow, but we'll see showers from Baltimore to the eastern shore and all the way down to the coast for Wednesday. Thursday, a chance for showers, especially in the first half of the day, up until about noontime. After that, the rain begins to move closer to the coast, and we'll see maybe a little bit of clearing late in the day before the sun sets. And that timing now and the showers shifting over to the east a little quicker is good news for the Oriole game. It looks like a 30% chance of showers at 3 o'clock, so better chance that it doesn't rain than it does. Rain chances going down as the storm shifts a little farther east. The winds will be coming out of the north. That'll put temperatures down in the low 50s by 6 p.m., about the time the game is wrapping up. And then after that rain moves through, Friday's looking like a nice day with sunny skies. Still a little bit cooler than normal in many locations, but bright sunshine for Sunday. Heading into the weekend, a little warmer, partly to mostly cloudy on Saturday and Sunday, highs in the mid-60s, and we'll stay in the upper 50s and low 60s with a chance for rain early next week. We'll be back with more news coming up right after this.
Before we sign off, we want to recap where we stand now, some 18 and a half hours after the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapsed into the Patapsco River.
Yeah, you know, a part of the Baltimore skyline, something that many of you have driven across for years, it's gone. It just doesn't exist anymore. And as of this minute, six construction workers are presumed dead. And search and rescue efforts have shifted into a recovery stage.
The federal government, from the president to the transportation secretary, are promising to cover the full cost of rebuilding the Francis Scott Key Bridge. 5 years of work lost in seconds, and it will take more years to rebuild.
And we know that a Singaporean ship ran into the bridge. That's what took it down. But the NTSB investigation into that is really just the beginning. Something else that will probably take years.
Of course, and tomorrow brings a new day with new challenges, and your commute might look a bit different. Yeah. Your view will not be the same as it was last night, but the city is coming together to push through this catastrophe.
That is the good news. All right, that's it for us here on 11 News at 7 o'clock.
We'll have much more on the collapse and recovery efforts regarding the six construction workers now presumed dead.
And that's coming up at 10 and 11 right here on 11 News. Have a good night.
Thank you for watching WBAL TV 11 News. Get caught up on local news, originals, and more. Download the Very Local app now and stream for free on Roku and Amazon Fire TV.